Gabriel Noronha, you are former special advisor for the Secretary's Iran Action Group at the Department of State. I'm very glad to have you on my show here from the University Club.
Yes, thank you for having me.
And my first question is, how do you evaluate Secretary Pompeo's work on Iran when you were his advisor? And if the U.S. sanctions aren't lifted on Iran, what would happen on an economic level?
You know, Secretary Pompeo had what I thought was a phenomenal Iran policy, and we instituted the maximum pressure campaign that really did massive things to change Iran and its ability to conduct terrorism and military destabilization around the world. Our sanctions deprived Iran of $200 billion in revenue that they would have otherwise had to, one, grow their economy, but really also to send money to its proxies like Hezbollah, Hamas, and the Houthis, and destabilize countries across the region. I think if you had seen the sanctions continue in this administration or been ratcheted up, if there had been a second Trump administration, what you would see right now is Iran's economy totally collapsing, and they would have gone into bankruptcy. Mm-hmm. Iran itself actually just released a projection that they kind of leaked it by accident, mm-hmm. which said that their debt would rise to $1.4 trillion in 6 years if the sanctions had continued all the way to then.
You said Biden's policies have increased Iran's accessible exchange reserves by $27 billion, over a 750% increase in under a year. How, and can you explain more?
Sure. So what happened when the United States left the Iran deal was that we snapped back sanctions on Iran's currency reserves around the world, and it locked up $90 billion of those. Combined with our pressure, Iran was down to just $4 billion in exchange reserves. So it had trouble conducting any trade abroad because it didn't have any money to exchange for anything. What the Biden administration did is they've stopped enforcing sanctions on Iran's oil exports. And so you've seen Iran export about $10 billion extra in oil. They also got a $5 billion bailout from the International Monetary Fund back in August that allows them to have all the money they need to buy and sell goods around the world. Mm-hmm. Basically, the pressure has been completely taken off. And the result is they don't have any incentive to strike a deal with the West anymore because they don't feel the existential threat of sanctions now.
So your assessment on Biden policies toward Iran is?
I think it's been a complete failure. They had one primary goal, which was to get back in the deal, and they haven't done it. And they haven't done it because they haven't even set themselves up for success. They weren't hard negotiating. They've been pretty weak the whole time, and as a result, they won't even get back to the Iran deal, which most of us believe is a very weak and unsteady deal to begin with. They also haven't been confronting Iran's terrorism. They haven't been doing anything about Iran's nuclear program that we've seen. And so Iran's nuclear program has just advanced over the last year with no consequence from the Biden administration.
In the latest news, Iran-backed militia storms U.S. embassy in Yemen, seize hostages and equipment. How would the State Department respond on that?
Look, this is incredibly troubling, and the fact that it's not the top story around the world is a little puzzling to me right now. They stormed, it's a former embassy building, but we still have locally employed staff there who are U.S. government employees. And I don't think the State Department is looking to have this be a story in any way. What they're trying to do is de-escalate the situation and negotiate back for the hostages, but they don't have much leverage to begin with, and it's unclear what they're willing to give in return. The United States has a policy that we do not give money in exchange for hostages, but I think it is likely that that is what the Houthi militias are looking for. They're looking for money, weapons, and political concessions, and we just gave them all the leverage they need.
Mm-hmm. How do you think Iran can benefit from Yemen economically, militarily, and strategically?
So they've used the Houthis to destabilize Yemen and create a drug trafficking network there, also money laundering networks through Yemen. But more importantly, it's a way to attack and undermine their geopolitical enemies, particularly Saudi Arabia, as well as their coalition with the UAE. Their goal is not, and they don't want to do anything with Yemen. They don't really care about the Houthi cause that much. They're even a different type of Shia. They have different Shia beliefs. What they're concerned with is they want Saudi Arabia's attention to be on Yemen and not on doing other things that could confront Iran around the world. And so their primary interest is simply to distract, destabilize, and cause as much destruction in the region as possible. That's when they believe that they can thrive. They did that in Lebanon with Hezbollah undermining Lebanon. They're doing that in Iraq with Shia militias there. And now Yemen is just their next plan there to take another capital.
You said the United States must end all negotiations with the Iranian regime immediately. Congress needs to do its part and snap back sanctions. The decision has to be made in Washington. Can you tell us more?
Sure. So Congress has this unique opportunity based on a law it passed 6 years ago where it can force a vote to end all sanctions relief to Iran and block any money from going to the regime. And that tool opens this coming Monday. And so that would be a powerful symbol that the Congress really opposes negotiations with Iran, and it won't accept any agreement that the Biden administration plans to make. I don't think these negotiations are going anywhere. I think the Biden administration is deluding itself if it believes it can go back into this deal or if it can get any stronger deal with its current setup. And so I think you've seen a lot of pushback from Republicans in Congress, but also some of the leading Democrats in the U.S. Senate have basically said this strategy isn't working. And so I think it's time for them to actually do something about it rather than just words, to force this vote and end negotiations with Iran.
Can you state what countries lifted sanctions on Iran? What about Latin America, like Argentina? What the U.S. can do about the smuggling or the oil trade with these countries?
So there's only really one country that matters for sanctions, and it's the United States. It doesn't matter what European countries say about their sanctions, because ultimately their businesses are going to look at U.S. banks and U.S. financial systems, and they're going to say, we want to be part of the U.S. financial system. We will never run afoul of U.S. sanctions. And so the European countries lifted sanctions back in 2015, but you don't have a single European country doing business with them now because of the United States. Same with Argentina and the rest of Latin America. They've cut off trade almost entirely with Iran. The one exception is Venezuela. And you've seen that there's been lots of oil ships going back and forth to Venezuela. The United States should be interdicting those ships and stopping that oil from going to Maduro. Maduro is using that money it's all corruption. He is a drug trafficker and a money launderer. It's basically—
And Hezbollah is involved?
And Hezbollah is involved. They're using that money to get weapons to destabilize not only Venezuela, but Colombia next door, and in the tri-country region next to Argentina, Paraguay, and Brazil. They're very active in destabilizing those governments and causing a lot of crime, a lot of violence there. And so it was very good to see a lot of those Latin American countries designate Hezbollah back in 2019 and 2020. But they need to be a lot more, a little stronger in trying to pressure the European countries in particular to take a stronger stance on Iran.
Mr. Noor, how do you evaluate the Israeli military attacks on Iran nuclear reactors? And now Israel readies for attacks on Iran nuclear program while we are on the stage of restarting the negotiation in Vienna.
So I think we've all seen over the summer and spring, there's been explosions in Iran's nuclear facilities. Most people believe that's from Israel. And I think if that is the case, it's been a great thing. It is stalling their nuclear program and making sure they don't have the opportunity to sort of break out to a nuclear weapons capability. The biggest question, though, is whether they have the interest and capability of bombing the nuclear reactors, sending planes over. They're messaging now that they are very willing to do so and that they probably have the capability to do so. But it's important to remember, if Israel takes that step and they launch planes and they bomb the facilities, it's probably going to strike a regional war. You're going to have Hezbollah and Hamas launch their entire rockets capability at Israel, because otherwise Iran would sort of show that it has no dignity, but it also doesn't have the deterrent capability to stop Israel from doing so. And I think that's the reason why you've seen Iran over the last couple decades supply Hezbollah with over 100,000 rockets and missiles to threaten Israel so that Israel doesn't do that. Israel only has one shot at destroying Iran's nuclear facilities, I think. And if they're going to do so, it would be very wise for them to have strong and coordinated support from the United States.
Mm-hmm. Will the negotiation in Vienna result in an agreement on nuclear Iranian nuclear program?
I don't think it will. I think Iran made the decision 4 months ago, maybe 5 months ago, that it didn't really want to have a deal with the United States because it doesn't think it helps it economically enough. And so I think Iran has been just toying with US and European negotiators ever since. And they're just trying to delay the talks as long as possible so they get as much sanctions relief as possible. I don't think there's any chance at this point for the deal, the old deal, to be reached again. They might try to do a weaker deal called sort of the less for less deal, where each side gives less to the other country. I think that's an even worse deal for the United States and Europe. But no, the JCPOA is dead now. And I think both sides truly actually understand that. And they're just holding on to a faint glimmer of hope now.
Secretary Blinken talked about alternatives toward Iran. Can you figure it out about what alternatives he's talking?
So there's this hope, I think, among his administration that he can convince the Europeans to snap back sanctions at the United Nations and join the United States in a united front against Iran. Now, this would be different from maximum pressure campaign, I believe, where you would have multilateral sanctions in place again. But I think they would also try to keep the pressure in check and not antagonize Iran too much. So they would reimpose some sanctions, but not the full weight that you saw under the Trump administration. Mm-hmm. The problem is with that approach is that you can either have full pressure or you can have zero pressure on Iran. Doing it halfway doesn't really work because it allows money to seep through the cracks and allows Iran to have enough of a lifeline that they don't want to have negotiations because they say, this is tough, but we can deal with it.
Do you think that China is helping Iran to become a nuclear power?
I don't think they're helping on the nuclear technology and the development of a nuclear weapon, but what they're doing is they're giving Iran an economic lifeline through these oil sales. Without these oil sales, Iran would be bankrupt right now. And Iran even needs the oil sales to fund its nuclear program. You need money to buy the centrifuges, and they've actually had difficulty with that at times, just not having the budget for it. And China is allowing them to do that. I think Russia is the one we should be worried about for the nuclear development cooperation, but they're both playing in a really important role in supporting and propping up Iran. And I think it's other countries in the Middle East, particularly Saudi Arabia and the UAE, which if they're not happy with Iran's nuclear program, they should be complaining to China more than Iran, because China is the one that's aiding and abetting all of Iran's nuclear, all their destabilizing activity, because they have that economic lifeline there.
Mm-hmm. John Kerry is lobbying against legislation to ban import of Chinese goods produced by slave labor. How can you read that?
It's very disappointing. There's been a fight in this administration whether or not we should have a stronger position towards China's use of forced labor and slave labor in Xinjiang, which produces these solar panels. John Kerry's view is that the climate is more important than any other geopolitical issue, and so we should allow money to go to China to build these solar powers, even if it's done with slave labor. That's a view that is really at odds with the rest of the national security community here in Washington, D.C., including, I believe, many of his other colleagues, including and Democrats, and as well as senators and representatives of his own party. Among Republicans, it's widespread condemnation of John Kerry sort of meddling here and supporting economic incentives to China.
Mm-hmm. You said to the Washington Free Beacon, now the regime is making tens of billions in unsanctioned oil aids with China, while Biden's Treasury Department looks the other way. What do you mean by that?
So the United States has seen all the oil trade that that Iran does with China, and it has seen this, and it hasn't chosen to conduct any economic sanctions. So they know who the actors are, they know the companies who are doing it, and by U.S. law, they're actually required to sanction these companies and entities and individuals involved in this trade. But they've chosen not to do so because they believe it will help them with the relationship with China in some way. Either that, or they just don't want to to antagonize Iran further. I think this is a big mistake. I think they need to be following the law. And every time they don't sanction these entities, it's giving billions of dollars to Iran that will ultimately be used for its terrorism around the region.
Gabriel Noronha, thank you so much for being with us. I'm so glad to have you on my show.
Thank you very much for having me, Maria.
Hey, Maria Maalouf here. Please click to like and subscribe to Maria Maalouf TV YouTube page and catch our hottest interviews and most compelling analysis. You will not get it anywhere else.